upgrade patches or service packs for installations because a function got fixed, you know, a bug fix. So do that. Like, I had this in the last years multiple times. Oh, it was on my screen. Yeah, but not on your submission because for some reason it disappeared. If that's happening, email, screenshot, help is coming. Yeah? Again, GIS can be highly frustrating. You can solve problems in 5 minutes or in 5 weeks. Yeah? Usually in an 8-week class, we don't have 5 weeks to solve the problem. Assignments, particular assignments, are not built to frustrate you, to challenge you, but not to frustrate you. And an assignment is not built that you need to work for a full week, full time on it. There's something wrong with your data or with your computer if you do that. Huh? All right. Who wants to play with GIS? Oh. Let's do this when we get to it. I want to play with JS right now, really badly. So what we're going to do is, I put shortcuts here. I don't need this one anymore. This is just me being trying to organize on a desktop. There's actually tools called fences where you can actually draw virtual boxes on it. But yeah, we can make fun of it, or we can just have fun. I want to open our ArcMap and ArcCatalog. Those are the two tools we're going to use the most, ArcMap and ArcCatalog. And what I would recommend, and this is the advantage of using this on your own computer, not on a lab computer, you can set up your own settings, and the system will keep the settings. What I will recommend to you guys, if you go here to the start area, and then go down to ArcGIS. Those are the tools here, you barely can see that. But here's ArcCatalog and ArcMap. I would recommend to right click on them and drag, or left click, drag and drop to your desktop and create a link. So you don't have to go down here all the time and zoom in and out, particularly if you work only from the mouse, or from the mouse pad or touch pad on your computer, not with the regular mouse. Got this?
I don't need a catalog, I have just map and scene. I don't want the catalog anymore.
Scroll down. Go to all map, all apps, under the letter A.
All apps.
Windows, all apps.
I think
they got it. ArcGIS folder.
Right there.
And then create this guy.
What was it? ArcMap? And what was it?
This is a board machine, we might have to.
Yeah.
Okay, so everyone got the link to ArcCatalog on your desktop.
Mm-hmm.
Don't start it right now. That's the next step. We're doing this really step by step. Patience, step by step. So I'm going to do this again. We click here on the Windows button, all apps, scroll or zoom down to the A letter, folder ArcGIS, and we'll find ArcMap, and we'll drag and drop with the left mouse button, link it, a shortcut on the screen, on the desktop. Because I'm lazy and I don't want to go through all these functions and find my app. This is old school shortcuts. Alright. So in theory you should have ArcCatalog and ArcMap. Everyone got this?
Yeah.
All right. So let's open up Arc Catalog. Fingers crossed, this is the first time we started. Fingers crossed that it doesn't explode on you. Everyone got it?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so Arc Catalog looks pretty much like this Windows File Explorer, huh? Stuff here on the left side, say, C drive, you know, I have my folders, yeah? And I have content here. Arc Catalog and File Explorer are completely different. Completely different. They don't like each other, they hate each other, they don't like each other, they are not even cousins third grade. The old structure of GIS data will show up here as one file. It will show up here as a folder with maybe 10,000 files in it. Or just five with the same name but different extension. Remember extensions like period txt for text or doc for Word documents, all that. Classic so-called shapefiles in GIS have 4 to 5 different extensions as one package. The new data models that's in a geo database, which is completely different, managed by itself inside, and it shows differently. We'll explore both worlds. Do not do maneuver data copy and paste in File Explorer unless you have it as an instruction with me. All the data we will deal with is inside Arc Catalog. Copy and paste, open, shift around. When it comes to file operations, we're going to do this in Arc Catalog. Is that clear? A lot of pain can be avoided, like work pain, but we do hold to that. Huh? Quick overview. Toolbars here, yeah. Similar language we use. Menus here, geoprocessing is a functional tool, we will come to that. I have the major part of a table of content, or the so-called catalog tree. Yeah. I have folder connections. You should have 0 content. Yeah. One more reason why we're going to do this on your personal laptops is because whenever we create a new folder connection, it will stay on your machine. If you do this in a university environment, it depends on the management. Usually, all the universities I've been teaching so far, in the middle of the night, all the computers reformat, fall back to the old stuff. Huh? So whatever you change, whatever data you left, it's gone. So, first thing what we're going to do, we're clicking here on this button. It says connect to folder or disk file, so you can work with its contents in the catalog. Now we gotta tell this guy, hey, this is our playground. So you do connect to folder, and it says here CD users T-word, so this is my username on this computer. For the purpose of this class, we click on this PC. Let me do this a bit slower. This PC, and there should be local disk Z. Everyone got that? And I click here on make new folder. And we call it GIS class. And you can capitalize and small caps it.
Which folder are we picking?
New folder. Let's see if this guy's.
I don't believe I have
except Windows.
So
OS. OSC? Is that what it is?
Could be OSC, yeah.
Okay.
Z drive.
Yeah.
Yep, operating system, click on this one, and say.
Windows 10? Windows 10?
Click on C.
Yeah, you have a folder.
Scroll up, you open it up, click on it.
Right, or?
Yeah. And make a folder.
I don't see.
Got this?
GIS class.
GIS class.
This one?
Yeah.
So in my case, it didn't work.
We need a folder GIS class.
Oh, no. Oh.
Can I make a folder?
Yeah, there you go.
GIS class, and then click OK.
The bad answer is an invalid, non-existing.
Yeah. Remember, I told you those are not even third grade cousins, so they don't like each other. GIS class. You got this? Click OK.
Yes.
Did you create?
He closed, he canceled, and went back again. Did the same thing.
Scroll up. See the GIS class, click on it once.
Click on it.
Yeah?
Can we folder again?
No. Find it,
don't find it there. Where's the
folder?
Yeah. GIS class.
And
sorry,
okay.
And now it's there.
Files.
Yeah.
This is the complicated part again. This is like during the family reunion, you have ArcGIS catalog doing an operation that is actually File Explorer. So everyone has this folder ArcGIS or GIS class. Everyone got the folder connection. You should see this now as GIS class. All right, one bonus point already. Yeah, this is our playground. So in the folder GIS class, what we're going to do now is we're adding data, we're copying and pasting data, but you know exactly when you look in Windows on your File Explorer, this, here again, File Explorer, this is going to be all what I do with my class. Downloads, assignments, everything. Huh? This is the folder I also will use for my USB jump drive for backups. Or if you use Dropbox, where you at least once a week take it and put it on Dropbox, separate copy. Yeah? Backup. If you don't have a jump drive yet, buy it. 2 or 3 gigabytes is good enough. And they're huge now, you know, for cheap prices. Those are $5 to $10 you should and need to invest. Yeah? Because you work for a week or two on a smaller project, yeah? And damn, the data is gone by accident deleted because you copy and pasted it wrong. Don't want to do that. Yeah? This is a fragile child. This is, you can be, as a new ArcGIS user, you can be this big elephant in the classware shop. Yeah? You don't want to make big vibrations and get in trouble. Yeah? Good thing is it's your own shop. If you break things, you can fix most of the time. All right, so let's take a look at some data. Got some data?
Yeah.
Yeah, you got some data?
We have?
No. So let's take a look here first. I have in our catalog here, in this area, I have contents, I have preview, says can't review anything, and you have description. So once we find data, we actually can look at stuff and explore it. So we got any data? Where would we find data? In our case, it's on Blackboard. So what we're going to do is we log into Blackboard. for Shaglern. And I will set up a Dropbox. That's maybe faster for some. Yeah? We go here to special topics. Let's switch this off so we can see it how you see it. We go to class content. Yeah? I put here a file on there which says GIS tutorial data. If you read the first few pages in your book, it tells you that there's tutorial data to download. You can do that through the SREE Press webpage. Remember the first bad attempt to download the software? There was data available. Or use this one. That should be the right version. Yeah? That gives you data as an example, downtown Pittsburgh, to do this unemployment map, etc. If you go, let's say, chapter 2, and you want to do all these mappings for different color sets, that is the data you need to use for that. Yeah? And I picked a few elements today, which is here, GIS data downloads. So we go here, click, click. Two data sets. And you can see already there's some funky thing going on. This is where I spent time and made it nice. And this is where I just sipped it this afternoon. We take both of them. I'll click on it. Should pop up. Downloads. Yeah. By downloads, I can go back and click on unitedstates.gdb.zip. And it pops up a 2. And you already can see there are different sizes. This is about 38 megabyte in size, and this is 113. Since we are now, everyone is ready to go on their machines, what I'm going to do is for every upcoming class when we do data work, if we don't generate the data by ourselves, I prepare the data so we can download Dropbox, etc., that stuff before. Yeah? Usually a day early, you should get an email, hey, download. So we can do this and we can start at the time we're not in the process. Right, and this is actually, we can close this. So now I have to open File Explorer. Yeah? And like I said, I'm lazy. I don't like this Windows environment with buttons and click here. I'm clicking the Windows key and E for Explorer. And it pops up. If my desktop is Windows, the Windows key on the board.
And E at the same time?
And E at the same time. And it pops up a File Explorer. Oh, okay. If you hit Windows key and D, don't do it. No, just kidding. Your desktop appears. Uh-huh. Boop. Clear it out. There are a few shortcuts that make life easy.
Windows key as well.
Yeah? Because the Windows key is not just only here to open up all these apps and all these. Yeah? New computer, this will be gone soon. This is absolutely non-productive. Yeah? But I have here the File Explorer. Yeah? Where I see all the downloads, etc. And I have here a file, this is the BC GIS data and United States. Yeah? What I also will do now is I right click on this, you're in Windows.
Download?
Should be in your downloads. Just PC downloads.
But it says like 15 minutes left.
15?
Yeah.
I got the PC downloaded,
but
the other
one's
not.
We're still
going to
show you.
15
minutes?
Yeah,
it's supposed to be 1 hour left.
Oh, there it is. the what? Open?
That's all this is on you.
Open with WinZip, is that what you're talking about, getting given two options?
Alright, all, everyone was downloading this faster, longer than 3 minutes. Yeah, WinZip. Are you downloading just the BC download?
Or the setup too?
It's actually, oh, the counter chat. Are you guys okay?
It's a hit one round. I haven't downloaded this in mind, but when I click it to open it.
Well, we can freestyle, we can shift the.
No binders, right?
No, it's inside your laptop. Right click on it.
On what?
Right click, yep. Open with.
Where are the title of the files?
Open with Windows Explorer. Alright. The BC GIS data, Broward County GIS data. Hands up, please. Who has this file downloaded? I know you don't have access to it. See, this is the reason why I post this stuff usually day early.
It's still downloading.
Don't do MS data.
No, I'm waiting for it to download. We have 3 minutes.
Alright, so.
We can't do anything wrong.
Should I put
this
instead?
Yes. What's so funny?
Okay, I'll take off the data.
Chase it.
Okay, and then open. Alright. Anyone still downloading? Jump the class now ahead of time, but it's okay. Concept first, then the play. Digitizing. Today's schedule is digitizing. Digitizing is the process of creating data with your computer. In this case, you know? You can create data in different ways with a GPS handheld, with your phone, but what we're going to do is you have different reasons to digitize, yeah? New maps, create something. New map features, or map features are wrong, missing features, and other reasons. One reason right now why we're doing the digitizing is because we don't really have data right now. Yeah? What we call the heads up digitizing, that's the new stuff, is because you have your head up in front of a computer screen. There used to be a time when you would lean over on a big board and we'd trace features with a cross-haired mouse. Have you ever been to an architectural bureau? Old school architectural bureaus would do that. Now where you draw lines on with a draw a plan and then you would digitize the line of the plan. So basically this example here shows. I did that. Well, not that old either, so. You know, we count age in version numbers nowadays. We don't count age in years.
But that's knowledge.
And so basically what you see here is a base map, some labeling on it, street names, and then locations. And what you could do now is you can use AutoCAD, because your architecture bureau presents that information, but you could have just simply a sketch. If you go out in the field, sometimes you just make a sketch where are things. You know, I'm a big fan of fire hydrants. My first field work with fire hydrants was going out with a regular map printed and crossed it with two or three features on it, like the number of the fire hydrant. Back in the office, zoom in, click on that corner, place a point, label it as a fire hydrant with the coating attached to it. Well, that's what you're going to do, but not with fire hydrants. We need to understand first GIS features. This guy is talking and talking and talking. We have points, lines, and polygons. Points, lines, or polylines. And polygons. Super important to understand what kind of geometry your data is. Typical representation of a point could be a single unit in the real world. A post, lamp post, a fire hydrant, could be the center of a statue, could be a dream. Just a few examples. It could be in the simplistic of scale and representation, a church, a capital city, or a building. Yeah? That depends on your scale and representation. Polyline, single feature as a point. Polyline is the next slide, gets a little bit complicated. Sometimes with points, and when we work with editing our data, we get a little bit confused because then suddenly they're called nodes, because this is the from and the to node of the line. Yeah? Because a line is defined in GIS as a starting point, as an end point. Because you can represent a street, as example, as a line, but you can represent a street in different directions when you do one-way streets. Well, GIS can create networks, and knowing the direction of the flow is important if you do, let's say, water or sewer networks or street patterns. So you can add additional information to the concept of your geometry. Phew! Brain explodes, okay. Now? Creating points, super simple. It's really super simple. Gotta prepare a little bit, but it's super simple to do. Like I kept telling you guys about food. So this is going, you're going to bake a cake. And the points are our eggs. So you prepare all the eggs, let them sit outside so they're not cold enough anymore, and we crack them. With every cracked egg, we are producing a point. Cracking eggs is not that simple, but it's easy. This is easier. This is coming later. Don't get scared. This XY event thing, we do that later. Single point feature, sketch tool, and snapping features. Purpose of this training tonight is just click on it. Don't worry about other things, snapping, etc. Basically, we will find real world examples and we just click where we want to place our point. Create that point as data. Then we deal with lines. And then it gets complicated. Remember when I said from to, from and to? This is when you do routing and complicated roads. Don't deal with this. But you need to expose, you need to see. The more you deal with engineering data, land use data, or with an architectural bureau, they deal with this stuff. So at least understand that there's direction in your line. 2 points form a line with a simple mathematics geometry. No? And then the polygons could be simple, like a square. Sometimes this could be a parcel. No? We represent with polygons usually areas, covered areas. In a complicated world, it's actually a line that is closed. Too much detail. Three or more lines joined to form a closed area. Super simple, three lines. This is not three lines, this is two. They form an intersection. Huh? Like a road outside here on the street light. If I add the third line, I create this area here. Like seventh grade mathematics. Huh? Super easy. You need to understand one thing. There are examples that work a little bit different. Exemptions. Hawaiian islands are usually multiple polygons, but as one group. We also have something which is kind of funny. That's the reason why I can try to make this as a donut. Yeah. It is basically a closed area. That's the reason why we call it a donut polygon. Kind of funny, difficult to handle. We are not going to do donuts. Not at least in the computer. Again, important to understand this is when we come back to the R catalog. When we remember there's this fields tab called Review. We can look at data as our features, point, line, polygon. Or we can look at the so-called attribute table. This is basically like somewhat an Excel spreadsheet with all the secret information on what the object ID, because those are multiple features, multiple polygons, you know, in one map, in one file. And then internal information, the length parameter in this case, and the area. And this is additional information like land use, or sales data, whatever we want to associate with that. Birthdays, female, male, any potential thing you can think of can be used to map out. Because the classic association, what we do is not enough space. You have a point, and you have your attribute table associate with this. This is the map, this is your data. You have an ID number, let's say 1, and it says shape would be point, and you could say this is a dollar value because this is a store, and it says $1 million. And then you have another point, number 2. Point, $2 million. Now I've already two elements, the value and the ID number, I can represent in that map. Let's call it maybe a name. Yeah? And have the name later on as a label. If you look at, say, an Excel spreadsheet, the only thing which is missing in an Excel spreadsheet compared to, let's say, the data here is this information knows exactly where this is located. Your computer, your system does this for you. That's what we call spatially enabled data. And all the pain we're going through is how to transform, let's say, a simple Excel spreadsheet, even from another class or MLS data. Yeah, on that location. The reason why you can see your MLS data on a map is because your data set, how many bedrooms, how many bathrooms, and square footage is associated with an address and there's a translation process that's called geocoding to that coordinate, all that long, x, y, multiple names for that, to the geographic location. That's all the magic of the non-existing magic. Well, in ArcMap, we will see certain docking tools. I'll open up ArcMap in a minute. We'll see now this is a great feature of construction tools for points, lines, and polygons. And it helps you here basically like preset, predefined examples. Yeah? With 10x as a version number, life really turned into easy with GIS. We'll do all these in a few. Right. Everyone downloaded the data yet? So we have roughly 90 minutes time to do get acquainted with ArcMap. We're going to find a so-called base map, yeah, something like a background. We're going to put Broward County data on it, point polylines and polygons. We do explore the data first. Never trust data you receive from somewhere, from someone. Always verify. Spend those 5 minutes in ArcCatalog and look at the table. Oh yeah, I sent you the census data. We're looking actually at census data for Broward County. Mark my words. We're looking at the census block groups, not the census data. We're looking at the block groups, at the boundaries. Because the data we just downloaded from Blackboard does not contain population data. It contains, in this case, the shape of that area. Like a zip code, like the typical boundaries of a city. Nothing else. But in our File Explorer download folder, here, there should be now a file that's called bc_gis_data, and it would pop up something like compressed zipped folder. Do you have that? So we can double click on this. Some might get an error message, or you can go and say right click on it and say open VIF, and it should come up with Windows zip, etc. No? This is the one few operations we do in File Explorer and not in ArcCatalog, because we just found data out in the world, just downloaded that. Someone of the class sent us the zip file. This is the format we will have most data share. Package into a zip, and then unpack it, extract. Yeah? If you have issues with that technique, I'm more than happy to show you the different ways on your machine. Some of the assignments in my past ask you to zip everything and submit on Blackboard. So I don't have 50 files flying around, I only have one. If you never ever have done zip a folder, like other way around, downloads, this is a file folder, just as an example. I can present a better example. I right click on this and it says send to compressed zip folder. I do this, and depending on its size, it's compressing. Oh, it's a big one, huh? And it will create a file in here. See that? Popped up. With the same name as the folder, but it shows as compressed zip folder. You can see it because it has all this icon has a little zipper. Yeah? If this would be an example for an assignment submission, it will say take the whole folder, zip the whole folder with your N number and rename into nnumber.zip. I will give you a step-by-step example. Orders. No panic. This is really step-by-step. And you go to Blackboard and upload them this one. Super simple. I can show you guys this, I can make you screenshots. This is a not to worry about, but you need to know. Super tool, cool and easy. Okay, let's delete this before it gets too clear. So I double click on this one. And there are different ways to copy data. And I'm a visual person, I want to know where and what. So I'm going to click again Windows E to open a second file explorer. I go to my Z drive and the GIS class. Let me rearrange that. So now I'm literally, I have two windows. And I use the technique we call since years drag and drop. Take this guy, click on it with left or with right if you move it, and copy it over into the GIS class folder. I can do this again if this was too fast.
Is it copy or cut? Copy.
Drag.
That
doesn't matter. This goal is you want to have in the GIS class, you want to have this data, the BC GIS data okay. Down here. What I do is I click on it with the left mouse button and drag it over and say just copy. This is new, this is fancy. It shows me speed up this. Alright. So now step by step. Do not click on the files. We're opening this folder to show you that those are different. They look different. Yeah? Double click. I have a folder here called GIS address points. Don't click, please. And I have big roads, DBR, big roads something, big roads PRJ, big roads SBN, SBX, SHB, SHP. All these is your street pattern for Broward County called big roads. All these combined. If you delete the wrong one, actually any of those, there's only one you can delete, not screwing up completely. If you accidentally copy and paste, cut one of these in the wrong way, bang. Can't display the data or empty data, can't display or empty. So careful, very careful, better is two windows, drag and drop. Make sure that you have it. Same thing here, Census Bureau 2010, all this is going to be one interpretation in your ARC catalog. So we can close this, we can close this, and we go back to ARC catalog. So in ARC catalog, we click here on the GIS class. And hey, where's the data? Just copy and paste the data in there. Yeah, our catalog likes to need or needs to have refreshments, as in refresh the view. Different ways to do this, right click on it, and you see the function called refresh. You also see F5. So depending on your keyboard layout, you can actually press F5. I will press F5. And now in content here, it popped up with our folder, BCGIS data. Got this? Nope. Drag and drop. You can't drag and drop in our catalog. You need to drag and drop into the other file explorer. Okay.
Windows, GIS. Bad customer. So if you have a... Users of millions of files, no more. Let's go to Windows GIS class. Everyone? Everyone can see PC GIS data in their folders. Again, a folder that says GIS address point. I had that before, yeah. But remember big roads, those 15 different files? One file only. Don't click anything. Just explanation here. Don't click anything. The only thing you click is going on this folder, VC GIS data. And you also see here census block 2010. But you don't see five, you see one. Yeah? It tells you the type, folder, and shapefile. There are two major pieces we will deal with. Feature classes that are in databases and shapefiles that are standalone little units. Yeah? You also see that there are different icons. Based on the icons, you can identify that this is a polyline, because this looks like a street, you know? And this is a polygon because it has these covered shapes. Yeah? All right. So we have review and description here as tabs. What we can do now is just take a look at big roads shape and go on review. Da-da. And changed here the view and we changed here the review. I can go on census blocks and da-da, polygons. Yeah? Rule one, if you get new data, explore and explore. Don't trust. The minimum you need to do if you get new data is you take a look in the preview tab here if it looks okay. This looks okay.
sometimes it could be distorted, like normally, if this is a piece of paper, sometimes it could look like this, or it's nothing, it's empty. Yeah? Because you could have data, but you don't have the shape. So let's take a look at GIS address points. This is a folder. If I expand, I see two files here. If I look at review, I see this kind of monster. Looks like a monster fish eating something. However, each of these points is a valid data point. We're gonna have some fun at 8:30 with GIS data. So, if I zoom in, it changes and adjusts for it. So, you didn't get that?
Yeah.
So now let's explore a little bit more. I have here a tab that says geometry or geography. Mm-hmm. We'll explore this in a minute. Don't do it right now. Double check first what you get here. This is in somewhat a coordinate system we have not explored yet. There is some really bad and big science behind and lots of mathematics behind map transformation and projections. We're going to have projections light. Literally, there are chapters and books about it. We're going to have a very short presentation. But the understanding is here, you need to check if these numbers add up in the setup of your playground. You are living in a sandbox. You're dealing only with Broward County data. That means all the Broward County data in this case should be in the same uniform, same color pattern. It's like a baseball team. Yeah? You won't be surprised if the Marlins would show up suddenly, one player on the Marlins field is in the Cincinnati Reds. Doesn't add up. Or the whole Marlins team is suddenly in a football stadium. Doesn't add up. Yeah? Gotta make sure that the data you're playing with is in the same stadium, with the same team, with the same colors. Yeah? If not, you have a problem with your data management. In this case, always look if what's going on with the unit and kind of the numbers here of the x, y's. You will see decimal degrees. You will see feet and meters. Depending where in the world you are, depending what kind of data you see, you will have these. Complicated life is if you get data that is in decimal degrees, preferably probably in lat long, you need to know how to transform that into the projection you play with. So if the door knocks and you have a football team standing in front of the baseball stadium, you need to know how to move those guys into the baseball stadium the right way. And there are one or two teams that play in baseball stadiums once in a while. Huh? Should I stay with the food stuff rather than football and baseball? I came up with those football and baseball stories because in Cincinnati they have the stadiums right next to each other down at the river. Literally, you walk less than 5 minutes and you're in the other game. So, it got stuck. So what we can do now is we explore the data. Let's explore first how the data is presented on the screen. So, for those that have a mouse on their computer, this action is done with the mouse wheel. Zoom in, zoom out, you can see the scale changes. Yeah? All this, all these points just zoom in, zoom out. If I get lost, I can press this button here. Full extent. Not this one. This is ArcMap. This is the globe with a magnifier class. Globe here is full extent. I can use the hand, the pen. If I click this, my cursor changes, and I can move the data. Or I can use a magnifier plus and minus, and draw a section, and then draw a section, and draw a section, and draw a section, and suddenly you realize, well, there are patterns coming up. I use the pen. It looks like streets, subdivision patterns, you know, something like a park or fancy alignment. Yeah? Something really cool. It says GIS address points. In the world of GIS, a address point is a locator of anything that can have an address. That does not include only your house, that includes everything that could have an address or a description with an address. Description with an address. So this is the funny part of exploring data. If you zoom out again, here, full extent, press that button. That line looks pretty funny for residences, does it? So if I zoom in, still a point because we can't change in the preview, can't change the representation. And I go to this very nifty tool called Identify or Inspector and click one of those, doesn't matter, it pops up and it gives me an overview. And that does read like a table, info sheet, MLS data. No? So don't worry about it right now, what is in there. But it says notes, call box. Yeah? It says street name, I-75, call box, mile 43.8. So this is actually along the interstate. Well, let's wait. I can click on everything else. It refreshes. You can also track and drop here. You click closer. Laura, if you click closer, zoom in closer, and then click on it, you see how I get this green flash. Guys, if I click here, you can see how it pops up the flash. This is the area where I identify. It's not like pinky, my pinky and tipping on it. No, it's smacking everything. I can smack there with my full hand pops up. You can see that there are multiple call boxes. Those should be mine markers. Yeah. So there's more than just residential. All right, let's take a look at the table here. I go to review, instead of geography, I take a look at the table. Now I can see that we're looking at item number one, first row. And don't worry about that, this is the feature ID number is zero, don't worry about this, this is automatic counting. No? It's point data, and all this is attribute data associated with those points. Broward County or the engineers of Broward County, whoever is in charge of that data set, created. Yeah? So the confidence gives you an indication if this is by whom was this created, and who is backing this information up. And then we get to that. You also see, did it just move? There should be a number. Here. You also see the total amount of data points and entries in this point data set. Something like 475,000 data points are like this on your screen. That's a lot of stuff you need to clean and visualize. Yeah? So we can go and zoom over here and see a little bit more data. See here XY coordinates, longitude, latitude, yeah? Date created, the street name, street number, street direction, street type, the full address. Yeah? And this is why you need to take a look, and I can see here city name. I also could go very easy if I want to know if this is so-called populated. I double click address point here,
and go to fields. And we'll actually see what kind of fields are included in here. So if this would be something with information, if I want to know if there's street name available, it should be a field called street name. But I need to look at the review if it's populated, if it's, because I can, it's like in Excel, I can name a column, but I have empty rows. Same thing here. Okay? Let's take a look at the other stuff. Big rows. Well, address points is huge. It's confusing. Yeah? But the message is the same with the next as well. We have a point on the map we can see in the preview, and then we switch from geography to a table. We can see what kind of data is behind the scenes. And that's the power we can use. Huh? So if you look at big roads, we have some streets here for Broward County. Now we know a little bit what is what. Huh? And we look here at the table. And you can see this is engineering stuff. Left, right, two node left. Huh? Left and right, but street name, some background or some coding, and the length. There's not more information than the street name and some of the length. But that is good enough to show a street label and its location. Huh? So nothing really enthusiastic about that. Roads are just roads. And sometimes we don't need that because we have an awesome so-called base map that automatically populates the road names. We'll come next. Census blocks. If I do the preview again here in geography, you see this. This is apparently a huge census block here. That's the Everglades. And you can zoom in and zoom in and zoom in. And you can see how real world is sliced and diced into pieces. And by luck, actually, this could be University and Griffith. It doesn't have other indicators than just this kind of layout. Yeah, so this is some interpretation. So census blocks and block groups sometimes follow, most likely follow, the existing residential and population. So you can see certain patterns if you look at Google Maps. This is a significant development pattern north of the interstate, of 595. Yeah. And this is the area of Pine Island. So this should be us. Yeah. But nothing, no coloring, nothing yet, just plain. If you look here at the table, we have some cryptic numbers. Like GOID, track, yeah, so county code, state code, county code, track number, block group, GOID. This is like a zip code, or like your address. Florida, Broward County, Davie, College Avenue. Code, breakdown, the hierarchy of the census. State, county, tract, block group, block. So, deja vu, online class, market analysis, first session. Then we have name, which doesn't really make sense because it's just a block. I would name your table tennis or golf balls, golf ball one, golf ball two. And then I told you already, there's nothing really in there. There's UR, UAC, A-Land 10, A-Water 10. So with a lot of guessing, you could argue that this could be amount of land in 2010 census. Amount of water 2010. Could be also by 10,000s. There's no information about the unit. This is definitely more than percentage. Yeah? So I don't know if this is in square miles or in square feet. At some
unknown unit. I could use it as a comparison or sorting data, which we can do. Same thing like you have in Excel as other stuff. I right click on this and I find all this. So I have sort ascending, sort descending, advanced sorting if I want, and statistics. So if I click on statistics, it gives me a count. In this data set, I have 21,811 block in that data. It tells me the minimum is zero, amount of land, yeah? The maximum is this huge number, without the commas and period points, so it's huge. It gives you a sum, a mean value, that's the average of all the values filled out, and it gives you a standard deviation, so you actually know a little bit about how this guy works, yeah? To left, to the right. So you could, in theory, you could say standard deviation is statistics. But one or two standard deviations, you have X percentage covered underneath that curve. If that is 68 and 95%, 99%, 95% is two standard deviations plus minus. You could actually say this is our distribution in statistical terms, not knowing what kind of distribution and what statistics. Yeah? Well, they're different curves. This is the typical Bell curve where we say, okay, fine, this is the assumption. Yeah. Could be like this. My dissertation worked with distributions like that. I have no idea, but it's a basic descriptor. Yeah? So how did I do this again? I found a field that displays a number. Listen up, this is important. I look at this one, this is left aligned. This is also filled with text. Well, this is the type of string or text. Typically, numbers, numeric values are right aligned on the right side. Typically, that's always a pain, always a mistake. If this is a number field, I can do statistics here on the text. See that? It's grayed out. This is a number field. I can right click on it and run basic simple statistics, which creates a pop-up for that field and shows me the numbers. If I do that for the water content, it shows me the number. Depending on your distribution, you would actually see maybe number of bar charts here in this area. So the simple way of having a breakdown on the average or the mean value in your data is right click on the numeric field and statistic. And you read the count and you read the mean as the average value. Count how many items you can count and the mean, what's this? So if there would be a field that says household income, you could generate the mean household income with two mouse clicks without even opening a map. Or export this in Excel and run this whole thing in Excel. Saves you 10 to 15 minutes time just to know. Right click, statistics, run it. Super simple. Yeah, the book is very eager about this with one or two pages. That's an exploration tool you always need. Yeah? So we explore census block, big roads, and address points. Yes?
In that last table that you were in, so say we find a specific point that we're interested in the table, how would we show that graphically on the map, like pull that out?
You want to select it? No, you can't. You can't select this here in ARC catalog. In ARC map, you can select it. Remind me about it when we do this diagram.
Okay.
But we're doing two steps now. All the place from the script, but we're doing two steps. We open ArcMap once now. Alright, you should have blank map here. Yeah? Don't worry about this, what I have. I cancel out, I get a blank map. Let me change this. I want to talk you through the elements of ArcMap, how it's organized, and then we add data to it. I'm doing this really step by step. Are you with me? Are you still okay? Do you need a break? 2 minutes run around? 3 minute break. Like literally stand up, walk down the hallway, up. Take a break. Something goes wrong, this is the other way to open up our map. Like, if our ArcMap, I have our catalog still open. There's this magic button here, ArcMap. Sorry, there are different ways to do this. Huh? As always, you always can travel the world in different ways, left and right, up and down. Huh? So instead of Windows, all apps, ArcGIS, ArcMap, I have a shortcut on the screen, on the desktop, which I could easily, you know, if everything is full of Windows, bang, Windows key D for desktop, and I fire up here my ArcMap, because it is a shortcut. Or I'm here, and I'm saying, okay, there's actually an ArcMap launch button inside ArcCatalog. There was no launch button for ArcCatalog in Math, so smart people included that actually as a docking here. No? This is good enough for easy operations. For the real cool GIS stuff, please close ArcMap, open ArcCatalog alone. Don't do ArcCatalog operations here. I know it's painful to wait 10 seconds for another window, but keep it separated and clean because it keeps you sane. Seriously, it keeps you sane. All right, let's talk this through. ArcMap construction. I have here the table of content. Yeah? It's empty because we did not add any data or what they call here layers. Remember last week I had this real world and onions in little slices, like a cake layer. We can do layers over layer over layer. We can switch layers in their color and their transparency so they are see-through. So you look from the top down to the ground and you shift layer into layer into layer. Sometimes you don't see it, sometimes they come apart and you can see. Yeah? There are other buttons here we will explore. Sometimes a little bit confusing. But in theory, the basic is table of content, tree view. In case the TOC disappears, can happen. Windows, table of contents. Click here, pops up again. It's one of those secrets. In case by accident you click on this or it disappears. Windows, table of content. Very important. The other important part is also in the book, you gotta do this. If the syllabus says read and review, it's good enough to read carefully. Now you get more acquainted with the tools and the operations. So you know suddenly, okay, this is the add data button. Fine, click that 5 times, I now can read it. If it says do the chapter, then do the chapter. Use the tutorial data from the Pittsburgh area and do these small exercises. Exercise like this, in file, map document properties. We've never seen this before, but there is a function called map document properties. If you click on this, it says here in the bottom, store relative path names to data source. And what this does, now we need this, I'm going to swipe. What this does is it saves your butt. There's no other explanation for that. So you right now you're in C, I don't know, user, let's pick Laura, L Lopez was it, yeah? Something like that, GIS class. You get this class. Huh? Actually. And you say you call it map. And we all store MXP files. That's just a name, but text. Huh? And she has data in here as well. We do the GIS class data. Yeah? It's called data.
The map looks for this. This is your data. This is where your points are or your lines. No? This is just abstract, so don't get confused. The document with that button not clicked looks for C, user, LoRa, GIS, map, and its data. So if you put that on a jump drive and give it to Chelsea, and Chelsea has exactly the same the stuff here, but Chelsea is Chelsea. Yeah? Won't work. You can't share the data. Or the document comes up empty. It actually comes up with, here on the side, you'll see with, it's grayed out with a red explanation mark. Red explanation mark, something is wrong. With the relative path, it doesn't care about this section. It basically notes the section, as we can see sometimes in computer stuff like this. And this data, etc. Very important. It kills a student's happiness in a computer lab because you have all these long file names and paths. Yeah? On your own machine, you might not have this problem because it's your own machine. But if you share data with her, you will have the problem. And that's one more reason why we do this. All of this in the file folder, GIS class on your C drive. And not on your personal folder. I think one of you, was it you or her, had it in your own user directory name. You need to click this to avoid trouble. Okay? So we need to click this and hit OK. And for in theory, as long as this version is installed on your computer, this relative file path button is enabled. In theory, for all new documents we create, standard. All right, check button here, relative path settings, click. All right, table of content, this guy here has two different functions. You can go here, on the lower bottom here, it says layout view and data view. Right now we're in data view. Remember we talked about map layouts? Mm-hmm. We click on layout view, we jump into the layout view. This here, the bluish line, represents what is written here as a data frame. You can build multiple data frames, like you have on your computer, a C drive, a D drive, you know? Different structures. This is mapped here. And once we fill it, you can see how this shifts around. You can zoom in, zoom out, you can create elements, and later on what we will do is, when we talk about map elements, neat line legends, north arrow, scale bar. Those are pieces we have seen today on a PowerPoint. Once we have the data running, we can put them in. Huh? So in layout view, I have my data frame here. And I can then later on put map elements to it. Huh? And again here, toolbar for layout. I can move this around and dock it up there, or I just have it float or have it disappear.
How did you have it appear again?
It is
gone.
How did you have that pop up? Well, sometimes if you switch here and here, it pops up automatically.
Okay.
It pop, you can exit out, and magic. All these extensions you heard?
Yeah.
So if I right click here in this area, right click here, that's slightly gray.
Okay.
All these are toolbars of extension and tools you can use for projects. Huh? Here's layout, here's editor to use for digitizing, yeah. Labeling all different tools. So if I click here on layout, it pops up again.
Where did you go for that?
I right click here on the toolbar area, right click, And you can go and find all these tools down there.
Okay.
Yeah? So if something's not showing up, don't panic. Double check if it's enabled here. Huh? All right? Then, we have here again the typical menus. File for file operations. Edit as we know it from other programs. Then bookmarks we'll take a look later. Insert is for the basically map elements. And then we get into the stuff Jason asked earlier about selections, geoprocessing tools, that's really working on engines and cars later on, and then other special elements. So the only thing we need is now data. There are two major ways to add data to a data frame. Two major ways. Let's do the lazy guy. Lazy guy goes in, has inspected the data in our catalog. And I think, okay, the census blocks look good to me. Lazy guy takes census blocks, play with it a little bit, sometimes that's sometimes the best way to look at content. Census block, left click it, keep the mouse button down, drag and drop here underneath layers. Into ArcMap. Want to do that again?
Yeah.
All right. I have ArcMap open. And I have ArcCatalog open.
Okay.
I found the data I really like, I really want to use. Yeah? So this is a new clean machine. But if you work this hard, you have 15 to 50 different folders with projects. So you need to know exactly what version, what kind of tool you want. So be sure what you want. I want census blocks. Left click with the mouse on it, highlight and left click, and drag and drop until it shows here that black line. So it's active. You can also track it into the map, but right now you can underneath layers. Because layers, if you right click on it, it's huge with tools.
Oh.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Alright.
Nice.
Super simple. Magic. So this is how you throw a rabbit into the head. Let me show you the other way, the conventional way. There's this plus button in ArcMap. Take the plus button, says add data, pops up a window that looks like our open data in any other application. If I click here, it only shows the folder connections. Remember, we connected to our GIS class folder. Go to GIS class folder. And for the fun of it, folder, one area down. Double click on it. Census block. Click add. One is you know exactly your target, you go for add button. Double click a few times where you want to go to the location. You know exactly the file. Highlight it, open it, add it. Or you do in our catalog, it's more the browsing part, double checking part, verifying that this is really the file you need. Is this all the census blocks or did we take out the swarms? You know? Could have different versions of it. But let's do this for the other stuff too. Let's do the plus button for the address points. Add data. Find GIS address points. So we need to click into this folder here and say add. And it takes a little bit to load because remember it's almost 500,000.
Wait, one second.
Okay. By the
way,
I removed this file with right click on it and remove.
Okay.
I take the plus button for add data.
Okay.
Click on it. I find my location, which is GIS address points, that one folder, GIS address points here, and add.
Let's start here. You have the folder called GIS class. You see a folder, it's called BC GIS data.
Yeah.
Double click it. You see our roads and our blocks.
Mm-hmm.
You double click the GIS address points. And then you'd say add. And it takes a while to load. If you don't want to reload the display all the time, what you can do is you press escape. It stops drawing the map. So the data is physically in the system, but not on your screen. So with a lot of data chunk on your screen, it takes a lot of time to display that. So if it's just about getting things started, hit escape, because then you stop the display. So you can look at the bottom here, if I would do this again. See, drawing, canceled with escape here at the bottom.
It's not drawing on my.
Who was that? Bridget.
Me.
Yes, we can. Simple map navigation. Now, as we have data, now we can navigate in our map. Welcome to our first map. Yeah? I have, similar to what I have seen in our catalog, I have a toolbar that has zoom in, zoom out, a pan, and full extend. If I click full extend, pops up for full extend. The plus magnifying glass helps me to drop an area of interest, and I can zoom in. And I can zoom in. And I can zoom in. Yeah? And it doesn't draw 500,000 points anymore, it only draws the points here on the screen, on the map you see right now. Yeah? And don't worry about where you're at right now. You don't have to follow exactly the zooms either. Don't. Or you pan around. Yeah? So now we can see streets as lines. Actually, no, this is the boundary of the census block. See that? Looks like streets already, and then the address points. So let's use our catalog to add actually streets to have our three guys together. So I go to big roads here and put them in here.
In our catalog?
In our ARC catalog, find my big roads. And click them, drag and drop them over here with left mouse button, hold it down. Big roads. Popping up a message. Message as what? Yep, close, don't worry about it.
Just don't worry.
Don't worry. So, let's go back to our catalog because we just learned something. When we preview data, I told you the story about look down here at the bottom, what are the units? Yeah? Yeah, I'm running around in feet. Yeah?
Is this what you
know? Census blocks are decimal degrees, and the address points are feet again. So what I'm actually doing right now is food. I'm mixing up pastry. I have pie and cookies. Still looks delicious on our mat, but it doesn't make sense. Huh? Gotta keep them separate.
So when we get that warning, do we say don't warn me again?
No, just in this case close. Huh?
No.
Just in this case close. So here's another rule that you need to know. So we have feet and decimal degrees. So there are different coordinate systems or projections. Huh? Different football teams, different leagues of football teams. For right now, we don't worry about this because we want to have our data arranged, we want to have color setups arranged. We are more concerned about visualization than data integrity.
the first layer here. The first layer we add to our map, to our data frame inside ArcMap. The first layer we add to the project defines the projection and are you going to be all cookies or are you going to be all files? Yeah? If you throw in a cookie, that cookie will be adapted on the fly into a pie. Yeah? But it will be different when you start sharing this thing, because you don't take slices anymore, you deal with crumbs. For visualization purposes, it's okay. In the beginning phase of a class, perfectly okay. If we want to calculate things like distances, angles, or areas, if I want to calculate the area of something, of something I measure in feet, what's my aerial unit then? It's square foot, is it? If I measure linear measures in miles, 1 mile by 1 mile is 1 square mile.